Hi guys, this is Joe Sanborn with the Music Group. I just wanted to welcome everybody today to our X32 Live webinar and user event. Today's topic is going to be the X32 and the P16 personal monitoring system. I just wanted to talk for a second about what the format is for today. Basically, it's a 1 hour presentation that we're going to be doing, followed by 1 hour of live demos. You can ask any questions just in general about the either the X32 or the P16 system, and we'll be doing those live demos right for you during that second hour. I just wanted to let everybody know how the webinar works. Everybody's microphone is muted for the course of the webinar. There is a questions box that you'll see in your GoToMyWebinar control panel. At any point during the presentation, if there's something that you want to ask a question about, there's actually a total of four of us from the company on the call right now, and whoever's not presenting will just ask your question at the appropriate time. If for some reason we don't get to your question, if we have to move on, they're in the queue and we'll get to all those questions at the very end. I also wanted to announce that we have a number of other events that are going to be coming up, particularly over the coming month, but there's two to be aware of. This coming Saturday, we're doing a webinar on the X32 and Logic, the digital audio workstation. That's going to be going on from 10 a.m. till 12 noon. And on this coming Monday, we're doing one on the X32 DCA subgroups and matrix mixes, and basically routing signals to those various areas on the X32. That is going to be happening from 1 p.m. to 3 p.m. this coming Monday. One last thing before we get started, I just wanted to mention that all the webinars that we're doing are going to be available. Currently, the overview X32 webinar that we did for the past couple of weeks is available. It's on the Behringer YouTube channel, and I think John is going to be sending out a message to everybody with the link to get to that first overview that's available for you guys. So without any further ado, we'll get started. I always think that it's handy when you're on a webinar to know who the presenters are on the other end. This is our U.S. product specialist team. This is myself, Joe Sanborn. John DiNicola is our senior product specialist. He's going to also be involved with part of the presentation and doing some of the live demos. Back up for a second. I'm located in Los Angeles. John is in Hoboken, New Jersey, that just went through the hurricane. So it's great to have John on the call with us today. We also have Justin Fry. He is our product specialist. He also resides in the Los Angeles area. And we also have Dwayne Wheeler. He is our Northwest product specialist, living up in the Seattle, Washington area. So that's our team that's on the call today. And the other guys are scattered out in other parts of the U.S. as well. You might see some of these people in the X32 game-changed van, which has been out on tour for the past couple of months since we launched the X32 product. And these guys are out doing clinics pretty much all over the U.S., but we also have product specialists in other countries as well. We have people in Europe and Asia and Australia, etc. So you might be seeing those guys out and about as well. All right, I wanted to go over today's agenda for our X32 P16 webinar. We're going to go over what is the P16 system, the general concept, benefits of using the P16 system, the Ultranet protocol. This is our exclusive Behringer protocol, which is used between the various P16 components using standard Cat5 wire. We're going to take a look at all the different P16 components within the system. We're going to look at wiring of the P16 components to the X32. The S16 stage box, which I believe is actually in stores. We're going to take a look at the S16 and how to connect that to the P16 and set it up. X32 routing configuration to the P16, basically how to get any signal in the X32 routed to any of the P16 channels, which we'll be going over. And we're going to do an example using a House of Worship P16 setup. And then, as I said, the last hour will be live demos and a Q&A section. All right, the Behringer P16, what is it? Basically, it's a 16-channel discrete monitoring system. This allows each musician to create their own personal mix. It doesn't have to be a musician. It could be used on a, you know, film stage or in different areas. Just anywhere where you have people that need either a headphone mix or a monitor mix, it allows you to completely dial in a customized mix to each one of those people. Not that long ago, to get into a discrete headphone system was extremely expensive. Usually you're talking, you know, in the $2,000 to $6,000 price range to get started with most of the other systems. All right, let's talk for a second. Why I talked about 16 discrete channels. Well, why are 16 channels better than, say, a two-channel headphone mix? If you're in a studio environment, a 16-channel discrete headphone mix, it basically puts the power of a complete mix in the hands of the artist, so they can just dial in their own mix. For engineers, whether you're a live engineer or you're a studio engineer, having a P16 discrete headphone system like this, it frees you up to do other engineering chores. The musicians get to dial in what they need. They don't need to communicate with hand signals to a monitor engineer on the side of the stage or the front of house guy. They can just go in and dial that in, and that frees you up to keep an eye on your, you know, your preamp levels or, you know, just different mix functions rather than dealing with dialing in everyone's mixes all the time. I would say this is a great way of getting a musician in the zone. I mean, if you give them the proper headphone mix, they're going to definitely deliver a much better performance. I know in recording studios, a lot of times we spend, you know, thousands and thousands of dollars on really nice mics and mic preamps and, you know, Pro Tools rigs and everything else. Well, this is just something that is going to deliver the most important thing before it even hits the microphone, which is getting a great performance out of a musician, because they're going to be able to hear exactly what they need and adjust it as they need to go. Once again, if the mix is right, you get the best performance. If you ask any monitor engineer how difficult it is to keep musicians happy, that's why a lot of the bigger bands obviously travel with their own monitor engineers. You know, this is just a great way to put that control back in the hands of the person that actually knows what they need. I want to talk about some typical uses to give you an example so you can visualize how this works. In a recording studio, let's say that you're going to record a rhythm section. So typically you have, what, a drummer behind a drum kit, you have a bass player, you might have a rhythm guitarist, and you might have a vocalist, maybe in the vocal booth or maybe even in the control room, and they're just going to lay down a scratch vocal so everybody kind of knows where they are in the song. Well, in the past, the engineer would have to sit there, and sometimes they might only have one headphone mix for everybody in the room. The drummer has different needs than the bass player, and the vocalist always has different needs than everybody else in the band. So with something like the P16, this is going to allow you to give each musician what they need. So let's take a look at the drummer's headphone mix. Drummers tend to like to hear their kick drum, especially when they have headphones on. So, you know, his kick drum might be at 80% up. He might want the bass guitar at like 60% in his mix, maybe the rhythm guitar at 55, and the vocals just kind of tucked, you know, way in the background just so he kind of knows where he is in the song. But, you know, with just that mix, he's able to kind of lock into his groove. The bass player, on the other hand, obviously he needs to hear his bass because his bass cabinet might be in another room mic'd up, or he might be using the DI, so he needs to hear a lot of his bass. A little bit of rhythm guitar, maybe the drums down a little bit below that, and just a little bit of vocals for reference. Rhythm guitarist obviously wants to hear his guitar, bass, maybe just a little drums and a little vocals. And then once again, the vocalist needs to hear their vocal mic, and then anything else they need to know, need to have in their mix as well. So with a P16 system, and we're going to be showing you all these components in just a second, if each one of these musicians in the studio had a P16M, our little mixer, and it was configured to the right channels using the X32, you could just totally give each musician their P16M and they could dial that in themselves. in live sound, a few different applications. This is a great way for musicians on stage that are using in-ear monitors. They can totally go in and dial in their own in-ear monitor mix. Now I know, you know, recently people have started to use iPads for controlling different mixes, and that's something that we're constantly improving on the X32. And we'll also have, you know, all that capability to do that from the stage. But, you know, something I always think about is, you know, during a live event, people are jumping around on a stage, you know, do you really want iPads left around? Not to mention a band up on a stage, the last thing they're thinking about is somebody possibly grabbing their iPad that might be lying on the stage. So the P16 is great for people with in-ear monitors because this is a hardware solution. And we're going to show you one of the accessories later on is a mic stand for it, so you can actually screw it right to a mic stand, and it actually screws in, and it's hardwired, so they're not going to walk away from the stage. So in-ear monitor is great use for the P16. Also, if somebody's still using, you know, possibly have a lead vocalist that doesn't like in-ear monitors and he's using a powered wedge, you could use this. It has line outputs on the back, so we could feed a wedge, and they could dial in their own mix. So there's a couple of live sound applications. And once again, in House of Worship, it could be the same situation. You could have, you know, a band up on the pulpit. The leader of the church, the minister, might have their own with in-ear monitors as well, so they could hear different things that are going on in the service. So it's just a way to give everybody exactly what they want in their own mix under their own control. Okay, the Ultranet protocol. This is a Behringer proprietary system that carries 16 channels of digital audio down a standard Cat5 wire. So this, everybody always asks as soon as they see the P16 and they think that, it's just using regular Cat5 Ethernet technology, and it's not at all. So this isn't a system that you're going to be able to just integrate with other, you know, items other than the cable. The cable is the same cable that you would use with standard Ethernet, but it is our own proprietary system. On powered connections, Ultranet can also carry power for the P16M mixers. So when we get into the components and we're connecting them in a few slides with Ethernet cables, that single Cat5 Ethernet wire is carrying 16 channels of discrete audio, as well as power to power the mixers as well, so you don't have to plug those into the wall. That only goes for these powered connections. If you're in a stage and you use the through jack on the back of one of the mixers, you could you can also through a signal that way, but the second unit after the first unit, you would need to plug that one into the wall. So I think it's always easier in more professional situations to just use the P16D, which we'll get into in a second. One thing people ask is, obviously, the X32 is using AES50, which is also down a standard Cat5 wire, and there is no danger if you were to accidentally plug the Ultranet into the AES50 or, you know, any different combinations. It's all worked out so that you're not going to cause any damage if you were to accidentally plug the wrong Cat5 wire in. And once again, do not use our Ultranet equipment with standard Cat5 hubs. It just basically won't work. Okay, I want to talk about the different components in the system. And the P16M, M for mixer, is our little mix station, and this is what the end users, the musicians and different people that need their mix, are going to get. We also have the P16D, and D stands for distribution. So this is just a way where you could take one Cat5 Ultranet connection and turn it into 8 powered outputs to feed 8 different musicians. And I just briefly, we're not going to talk about this much at all other than this mention now. We do have another piece, which is for non-X32 P16 applications, and this is called the P16I, I for interface. And this is basically just a one rack space unit, and you can use it if you're not using an X32 console, and say you're still using an analog console. You could take either direct outputs on an analog board or bus outputs, and it's basically a one rack space unit that gives you 16 TRS analog inputs on the back, and it also gives you two 8-AT light pipe connections on the back for 1 through 8 and 9 through 16. And then it gives you six powered alternate connections on the front to feed out two stations. So just keep that in mind if you're not on an X32. Okay, just quickly looking, this is our P16M. This is the mixer. That's the front and the back of the unit. And we're going to be going through what all the different controls are in a few slides. This is the P16D that I mentioned, the distribution box. You'll notice on the left, there is that alternate in, and then there is 8 powered alternate outs. This is a small, like a half rack size unit. A lot of people will mount these onto a standard 19-inch rack mounting tray and just put this right inside of their stage box, particularly if they're using like the S16 stage boxes. And on the back, you just have one standard IEC power to power the thing up. A few other things on it. There's also light indicators, which will show you if there's signal present on any of those various alternate ports. Okay, I want to talk about the X32 P16 connection, and there's basically two ways to get P16 signal from the X32 to P16 components. There is a direct alternate connection on the back of the X32. So if you're not using our AES50 digital snake technology on the back of the X32, say you're in a recording studio and you have an analog snake and you're not going to add the S16s in, there is a dedicated alternate port right on the back, and you just would plug right into that and then take that and plug that into the P16D. If you are using the X32 with the S16 stage boxes, keep in mind that on the back of the S16, and we're going to show you this in some graphics in a second, there is an alternate port right on the back of the S16. Now, what's cool about that is you don't have to run two wires either to the stage or, say, from your control room to your live room in a studio. It's just one Cat5 wire. You run it from that AES50, you plug in your S16, and it's also carrying your 16 discrete channels for your headphone monitoring system. Okay, so let's take a look at those two examples. On the top, we're showing the X32. This is the back of the board. And the middle graphic is showing you a blow-up of the alternate port, which is kind of right in the middle section. So if we were to take that using a standard Cat5 wire, that would go right into our P16D. And then basically you could take any of those 8 powered outputs on the P16D and plug those into P16Ms into the in jack on the back of each of those. In this example, we're showing an X32 at the front of house position, or say in a control room. We've got one Cat5 wire coming from AES50 plugging into our S16. On the back of the S16 is one alternate port out, which would feed into that P16D right above it, and then each of those 8 outputs, as we're showing, could feed 8 musicians. So each of those ports that are plugged to those P16Ms don't even need to be plugged into the wall. They're also powered right from those power jacks on that P16D. Okay, I'm going to turn it over to John DiNicola. He's going to take us through some of the functions on the P16M.
All right, great. Thank you, Joe. So the first component here, we're going to talk about the P16M, Personal Monitor Mixer. This is the mixer that every musician would have on stage. So first we'll talk about dialing in your personal mix using the controls on the surface, and then we'll talk about the connectivity that you have on the back of the P16M for getting your mix out to the monitors. So taking a look at the surface of the P16M, we're going to go through some of the controls here. The first arrow you see are pointing at the channel selects. So basically, you would just any channel that you want to adjust, say your vocal is on channel 1, you would press channel 1, and that would activate the channel, you know, the volume control, or the pan control, and the EQ for that channel. It works just like the select buttons on your X32. And you'll also notice that there's two lights on each select button. The green light is going to be a signal indicator, so you'll always know if signal's coming in on that channel, and the red light is indicating that the channel is selected. Next over here, we have solo and mute controls. So again, when you have a channel selected, you can press solo and that channel will solo. If you press the mute button, you can go ahead one by one and select channels in order to mute them. To the right, probably the most important control, of course, is your volume control. So as I mentioned before, you would just select the channel and then you could raise or lower its volume using that encoder just up to the right of that arrow. I also want to mention that, that the volume encoder is also a push button. It's like a panic mute function. So if you press that button in, it will actually mute that channel. So if you're having trouble turning up your volume on a channel, first thing I would tell you to check is by pressing that button. Maybe you just have it muted. Right to the left are going to be your pan and balance controls. So any channel that's selected, you can pan to the left or to the right. And this button is also a push button. So when you push the pan button, it'll actually return you right to the center. So that's a nice little shortcut. Right above that is our equalizer. And this is a unique feature on the P16M in that the EQ actually works on every channel individually. And it's actually a three band with a sweepable mid. So this really allows you to dial in pretty good mix for on this little P16M. So if you wanted to EQ a channel, you would select a channel. And you actually can do an EQ on the entire main mix by pressing the main button all the way to the left, which we'll highlight in a second. Just to the right is our output section. So you do have a limiter to protect your ears in case a nasty feedback loop gets going or anything. And then just to the right of that is going to be your level control. That's your final output level control, you know, for your headphones or to your floor wedge. Over back to the left is that main button I was talking about. So when you want to think about the main button almost like a master fader or your main left right. So if you want to EQ the master mix, select main and use the EQ. This is another thing you want to check here is the volume on your main. There's actually a separate volume for your main control. It's almost like a master fader. So if you're not getting enough volume out of the P16M, the first place I would check would be by pressing main and making sure you have that dialed up, maybe not all the way, but you know, definitely close to it. And that'll open up a lot of headroom for you.
Just wanted to mention, John, that also when you're on that main, your volume encoder also becomes a master kill switch.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, it's a great benefit of having that. So you have two ways of, you know, you can either press that button really quick or you can hit the mute button. And in order, you know, as Joe said, if anything goes wrong, you can press the main and have control over that right away. Now up on the upper left-hand corner are the setup buttons on the X32. So all the way to the left is a link button. So if you press the link button and then you press a channel, it'll basically link to the adjacent channel. So this works exactly like the X32, where you can link 1 to 2 and 3 to 4, basically odd even pairs. And when you do this, it'll automatically pan those guys, you know, opposite left and right. Next over to the right is the group button. This allows you to, you know, group channels together. Say you have 8 channels worth of drums, and you already dialed in the drum mix, and you just want to be able to control the drums. It's actually just like the DCAs on your X32. So you just press the group button, and then one by one, you can press channels, and you'll notice that those channels will all light up red and blink, indicating that they're part of a group. Now, to the right of that, we have our store and recall buttons. Just like the X32 has 100 scenes, the P16M has 16 recall slots. Basically, each button acts as a slot for a scene, you know, for the P16M. So that's really simple to do. Basically, you press and hold the store button, and then you would, at the same time, you would pick one of those slots and press it twice, and it would lock into there. And then if you ever wanted to recall that scene, you can press and hold recall, and then, you know, press the button of that slot that you saved to. And we'll probably have Justin show you that on the webcam in a little bit. So that's the surface of the P16M. So let's take a look at the back panel. Starting with, of course, the headphone jack. It does have a dedicated headphone jack with a pretty high-powered headphone preamp. So if you're using headphones or directly to an in-ear. To the left of that, you also have a stereo line out. So this is great if you're using a powered floor wedge, like our F1320D. Next, we have a MIDI input. A lot of people ask what this is for. And this is really handy if you want to use something else besides the, if you want to control the mix on the P16M with something else, such as our BCR2000. You know, that would allow you to have maybe all of the volumes on separate rotary encoders, so you wouldn't have to use the select button. Or maybe you'd use the BCF2000 to, you know, put your mix, your channels on faders or some other controller. So you have that ability on the P16M using the MIDI in jack. Next to that on the left is our alternate. Of course, there's an alternate input that would be coming from your P16D or your direct connection to the X32. And then to the left of that is a throughput jack. So you actually do have the ability to daisy chain P16Ms together. You'll notice there's a little picture of a power adapter above the P16M, because if you're using a through jack, your power is not going to transfer over to the next mixer. So even if you're connected to a P16D, only that first P16M is going to get power. And if you use the throughput jack, you're going to have to plug that second P16M in with the included power adapter. So the P16 system actually has massive expandability, because any output from the P16D can feed additional P16Ds to get up to, I believe we've tested it with 48 or 64 units, but I've been told that it could possibly be even more than that. So pretty much enough for most scenarios that I can come up with, you know, pretty big symphony or orchestra pit or any other scenario. So now I'm going to hand it back over to Joe. We're going to talk about how the S16 integrates with the system.
Great. Thanks, John. So yeah, we're going to take a look at our S16 stage box. Along with the P16, this is obviously one of the number one add-ons for an X32 mixing system. And basically, this is our stage box, or if you're in a studio, this would live out in the live room, where you're going to be miking up the different instruments. In our application for today, I just really wanted to point out a few things here. We have an arrow down at the bottom on the back of the unit. This is showing us where that alternate port is on the back. So this is basically you're running one cable from front of house position. Maybe you're using AES-A port on the front of house console. You run that one Cat5 wire down to the stage. You plug that into maybe the A port on the AES-50, and then that one cable is also going to be delivering your 16 discrete channels to the alternate port. So that obviously would just come out, would go into a P16D, and then you would use those 8 outputs to feed out to the musicians. So this is basically a graphic which is showing us a typical system. Here is our X32 at front of house position. We're taking our AES-50A port down one single Cat5 wire to two S16 stage boxes. Obviously, on the X32, we could use a full 32x16, so it's totally appropriate to have two S16s, where you'd have your 32 ins and then your 16 outputs. And the alternate port on the back of the bottom unit would basically just feed out to our P16D unit. And then each of those 8 powered outputs would feed out to P16Ms. Maybe this is for our lead singer. Maybe this is for the rhythm guitarist. And we could take those line outputs on the back of those, and we could plug those into powered wedges if they were using powered wedges, or obviously to in-ear monitor transmitters as well. Wanted to mention, as far as accessories go, we do make a unit that mounts directly to the bottom of the P16Ms. It's called the P16MB, MB for mounting bracket. And one thing that's very cool is this mounts right onto a mic stand. I know, I believe it's the AVM system where the individual mix stations actually have to mount onto a separate mic stand, which just adds a lot more clutter to a stage area. So these are really great little mounting brackets. One thing that I like about it is it's really robust. I mean, it's got a nice handle on it. When you screw it to the mic stand, it's not going anywhere. It's not going to flop over on you, et cetera. So it's a nice little accessory for your P16 MVs. Obviously, it also keeps them up off the ground where they're not getting stepped on and broken. Okay, I wanted to talk about the P16 bus on the X32. This is a dedicated bus. Obviously, the X32 has 16 internal buses, obviously used for effects sends or monitor sends, etc. So what's really great is the feeds that are feeding the 16 buses on the P16 aren't eating up your other internal buses. So this is a completely separate set of 16 buses that you can assign out to the P16. And we're actually going to be showing you that in just a second with our example. If we take a look at the screen on the X32, basically this is where you're going to route the signals that are going to each one of those P16 channels. Up near your screen on the X32, you would just click the routing button, and you'll notice that up here on the top, you would use your page left and right to get to the different tabs within the routing. So obviously we want to route the P16 output, so you go to the P16 out tab. Starting in the middle, all the way to the left where it says digital out, that's listing your P16 channels. Due to the amount of screen space, obviously it's only going down to output 14. When you use that first encoder, it would then click down to 15 and 16 when you got to the bottom of that list. And then from there, you just work left to right. So right now we're on P16 output 1. If we jump over to where it says category, advance the slide. This basically is going to jump the next list to the corresponding area as far as what's assigned to that output. So for instance, right now it's on direct output. And then direct output would bring up any of the direct outputs that we could then assign to that P16 channel. Maybe we want to use the main left. Maybe we want to use the main right, or any of the 16 mix buses, or any direct output on any individual channel. We could even say, I want to use channel 1. That's my kick drum's direct output. And the next column over also allows you to select where you're tapping that signal to send it on the P16 channel. Do you want it before the EQ? Do you want it after the EQ? Pre-fader, post-fader? So it's very flexible as far as routing those, what signals are going to your 16 channels of the P16 bus. Wanted to talk about a real-world example. This is a church that had contacted us with very specific P16 channel requirements. So we gave them a hand to get that dialed in. They basically were using 32 channels at mix on the X32, and they wanted to use all 16 channels on the P16 with very specific signals. So basically, this is what their end outcome was that they were looking for. On each musician's P16 station, they were using a click track because they were playing with some loops. They wanted to be able to adjust all the drums. You know, you might have 10 drum mics, and they wanted them all just to a left and right, you know, subgroup so that they can adjust drums up and down, bass, guitar, you know, keyboards, then all the vocals. A lot of times with in-ear monitor systems, people are also setting up a crowd mic because obviously if you have in-ear monitors in, you're a bit isolated from the crowd, so they wanted a crowd mic that each musician could adjust up or down. A lot of times during the church service, they were playing different video clips, so they also wanted the audio that's coming up on the big screen, so they have a volume control for that, and also the overall effects level. So basically, this is what we came up with for them. And in the first column, this is just showing us what channel each of these different inputs are coming in on. Obviously the input name, click, loop, kick, snare, etc. The third column over is which P16 channel, which matches our left graphic over here, we wanted each one of those inputs assigned to. And then the fourth column is where we actually are going to tap those different signals to send them down the corresponding P16 channel. So I think what we're going to do is we're going to go to John's X control screen, and John's going to actually walk us through assigning some of that plot.
Okay, thank you, Joe. I'm just going to have to take the screen back from you, which I'm doing now. Okay. So great. Now everybody should still see the spreadsheet on the right, which is showing that same track list that Joe had. And now on the left, you can see I have my X control set up basically with this layout. So all my inputs are labeled just like they are on the spreadsheet. So I'm just going to take you through one channel at a time and get it all assigned to the P16. So we'll start at channel one, the click track, and that's going to be an easy one because we're just going to take a direct out from that channel. The click is coming in on channel one, so we're going to click on P16 output one. We're going to use
Hey, John?
Yes.
I'm sorry to interrupt, but we are not seeing your screen, it looks like.
Okay. All right. Oh, that's my fault. How about now?
Yep. Okay. Yeah. So you might want to start over there just because I think we weren't able to see the beginning part.
Yeah, great. No, thanks for that, Justin. No problem. You didn't miss too much. Basically, I was just outlining the fact that I have that same input list on the right-hand side of the screen so you guys can follow along. And then I have that...
Excuse me, John.
Yes?
If you don't mind explaining for anybody that's new to the X32 what X control actually is.
Oh, sure. No problem. The X control software is PC software, which I'm actually running on my Mac with a cool little emulation program. But the current version is for the PC. And it allows you to control the X32 live, you know, almost like you would on your iPad, but on your computer. And we do have iPad software as well, but this is our PC program. So not only does this allow you to work on your X32, you know, during a gig, but it actually allows you to be, it also works as an offline editor. So you can set up your scene just like I have and save it and then load it onto the X32 once you're going to the gig. So even if you guys are, some of you out there might be considering buying an X32, want to get a feel for how the routing is and how the channel strip looks, just go on to Behringer.com/X32, click on the downloads page and check this out. It's pretty cool. And like I said, if you do end up buying the mixer, you can get everything set up ahead of time. So because the screen on here really emulates the mixer so well, we like to use this program for our demos. Just gives you a really clear, so you can really see the routing page and everything. But of course, there are going to be slight differences. I'll try to point them out as they come up. So that's the X control, and that's what's on the left-hand side of my screen. And on the right-hand side of my screen is the input list, and it's reflected right there on the console that you can see. So let's just pretend we're not on the P16, and we got our mix coming, and front of house is looking good, and it's time to get the monitors going. The first thing we need to do is get that click track going out to the P16. So we're going to go to the routing menu, and because this is just a simple, you know, one channel input, we just want to take a direct out. This is really easy. We're going to select P16 output one, and then we're going to go over to category, and you see I already have on direct out, and you'll notice I'm clicking. Now on the X32, you'd be using your rotary encoders right below the screen to do the exact same thing I'm doing with my mouse. So you'd use direct out. And since our click is on channel one, we'll take the direct out of channel one. And for this example, I'm just going to keep everything on a pre-EQ tab. So that's all I have to do. Now channel one is all set to go. We're going to repeat that same process for the loop. We want to put that on P16 channel two. So I'm going to select P16 channel two. I'm going to scroll down and make sure that it's already selected on two. Again, pretty simple. So we have one and two ready to go. Now we run into a problem because we have all these drum tracks here, and as you can see, you know, way too many channels on the X32 to fit through those 16 channels. So the best way to get around this is to utilize some of your 16 buses and set up some subgroups. So I'm going to show you exactly how to do that. And you can see on the right-hand side of my console, I'm looking at the bus layer. So I already have my first two buses labeled, you know, drums left and drums right. So on my kick drum channel, on the X32, I would select it, and I would press view near the bus send encoders on the channel strip. And this is the screen that you would see. And then using the layer down button on the X32, you would reveal the controls that would allow you to change this that I'm changing right now. You would be able to change this to subgroup. Once you change that to subgroup, you've made 1-2 a subgroup, and the kick drum is assigned. So now all you have to do is go to the rest of those channels and do the exact same thing. Channel 4, select, you know, put put it onto subgroup 1 and 2. Channel 5 select, we'll put it onto subgroup 1 and 2. Same thing with the rest of them until we get all of our drums going down that 1 and 2 subgroup, which I already have labeled, as you can see on the right output, on the 8 output faders on the right. So now that I have that all happening, I can go to my routing menu, and you'll see on the spreadsheet we want the drum set to come out at 3-4 on the P16. So I'll go to P16 output 3, and instead of being on direct out, I'm going to go to mix bus, and since the drums are on mix 1 and 2, I'm going to go with mix bus 1, and then I'm going to repeat this for P16 output 4, and this time we'll choose mix bus 2. So now I have all my drums going down two P16 channels. And so we already have all the drums, the click and the loop, and we still have 12 P16 channels to go. So next on the input list is bass. For all the guitars, we want to be able to control those individually. So we're going to go back to taking direct outputs. So for number 5, because that's what we have in the spreadsheet here, we'll go to P16 output 5. And we're going to take the direct out of channel 11, because as you can see down here, that's where my bass is. And we're going to go right on down and just continue doing this. Acoustic guitar is on channel 12, so direct out channel 12. Then we go to P16 channel 7, and we'll take channel 13 for my first electric guitar. P16 out number 8 will be direct out 14 for my second electric guitar. And now we have 4 channels of keys, 2 on the first layer here and 2 more here. So we're going to do the same thing with the keys that we did with the drums. So we'll just simply select the keys. We'll press view near the bus send section. And you'll notice on the right-hand side of the console, I have mixes 5 and 6 set up for my keys. So I'm just going to go over here to the sends. With my key track selected on 5 and 6, I'm just going to change that to subgroup for all of my key channels. So now I've created a nice little subgroup that I can send right to the P16. Once I've done that, I go to routing. And I want to use P16 channels 9 and 10, so I'll take channel 9. And we're going to use mix bus 5 because that's where my key subgroup is. And then we'll do the same thing for channel 10 to pull in the right side of the keys. And then we're going to just continue on down the line. Basically, we definitely want to have control of our lead vocal. So we'll pick a channel 11 there. I guess our lead singer in this case is Kevin. He's on channel 19. So I'll assign direct out of 19. So one more thing we had a subgroup together is the background vocals. Basically, they didn't need to have control over all those together. So same process. We basically selected the first background vocal. We press view near the bus sends, which takes us to this screen here. And our next logical mix is going to be 7. So again, I just engage the subgroup for 7-8 here for all my background vocal channels. Again, now I can go to the routing menu, take my P16 channel 12, and connect it to mix bus 7. My ambient mic, that's going to be a direct out on channel 13 of the P16. Direct out, and we can see right down here in the red, it's coming out of 23, so let's bring it on down to 23. And there it is. And we actually did some subgrouping on those 3 computer channels too, because we had a stereo coming from the Mac and we had a DVD. So I was able to subgroup those down. And basically that's, on the line. And the last thing we did was the effects. We actually just took all the effects and we made those a subgroup as well. So those effects come back in here on layer 3. And when I'm talking about the effects, I'm talking about the 8 internal effects processors that you see right over here. So we're going to just, instead of having 4 returns, we want these all to come up on 2 P16 channels. So again, we'll do another subgroup on mix 9 and 10. We can select the effects channel, press view near the bus sends, and we can go ahead and we're going to use mix 9 and 10. So we'll do a subgroup on all those. And now all of our effects will be on mixes 9 and 10. And we can go ahead on the P16 and route those right out that last pair of P16 outputs. So there you can see that's one example of where you have more than 16 channels that you can utilize the mix buses on your X32 to do some subgrouping. And chances are, if you're using a P16 system, you know, you're probably not going to have as many wedge mixes. In this example, you know, a lot of times you might have a couple because some guys want to just have a regular wedge that's controlled by the sound guy. Well, maybe you have two wedges, and you can see you're still left with plenty of buses on the X32. So that's what I usually suggest, starting with the drums and then whatever else you're willing to subgroup down, and take a mix and match between subgroups and direct outputs. And usually you could be on your way to having a great set of 16 channels to choose from.
Yeah, John, I remember when we put this together for this church, this is definitely, it's just a great way to do it. If you have something like, you know, a spreadsheet or whatever, just to lay it out in columns, it makes it a lot easier. I remember even for this one, we made them a preset and sent them a preset file, and they just loaded it into their console, and it was all ready to go. So, yeah, either you could do it in X control, as we did here, or just having that spreadsheet kind of laid out when you get to the console later on, to kind of go through, and you don't have to second guess. You just kind of, you know, blast through the different screens to lay it all out. I remember in this particular church's case, there was a lot of they had a need for a number of different mixes going to different places. They had a video room, and we also had to get into the different DCAs so that they could create little sub mixes to go to some of these different areas. So the subgrouping worked great for the P16 bus, but it also helped out with some of those other matrix mixes, etc. So, yeah, great job.
Thank you, Joe. I had a question here from Henry. He says, did I make a mono or stereo subgroup for Bvox and DVD? And actually, when you're doing these subgroups, that actually happens in pairs on the X32s. Basically, because subgroups here behave just like on analog boards, where the send to the subgroup would be exactly what's going to the main left, right. And that's usually good enough. If you don't want to, if you want to just get a mono one going, I would just go with like a post fader send. And that basically would accomplish the same thing. I would send everything post fader send to like just 7, and that would be a mono for you. I hope that answers the question.
I'm just going through a few of these questions. Somebody was asking about a MIDI implementation chart for the P16, and that's definitely available, I believe, in the just go to the P16 product page, and in the bottom, I believe that there's a tab to go to different downloads, and you can download that implementation chart. If it's not there, then it's in the back of the manual, but maybe one of us can check as we're answering other questions.
So I'm just going to clarify what I did there with the, let me see, with the background box and the DVD separately to the P16, or the M16, the P16M, sorry. So let me go back here to those background vocals, and we'll go to sends. And actually, yeah, in this case, we do want to do a post fader so that we can get separation there. So that's how we're going to do it. By doing a post fader send, it's not locking 7 and 8 in a pair. And that's kind of the main difference. When you do a subgroup, it's going to kind of lock those left and right as a subgroup. If you're just doing a simple post fader send, then you could, so we'll go to, you know, we have a 7, just because 7 and 8 are both post fader doesn't mean that you have to send to both 7 and 8, you see. So I'm just going to send the 7 in this example for these three vocals. Just like that. I would recommend putting it at 0 dB, maybe a little lower. And then for the Mac and DVD, I can go on and just turn up 8. And I'm able to do that because I did post fader rather than a subgroup. So I hope that's a little bit more clear. And then that's how we get that separation. Basically, you're just telling it to sum that to a mono bus. And of course, since they're separated, 7 and 8 on the P16M, you would just go to the routing. And in this example, the mix 7 or on 12 is where we want the background vocals, and then we can just pick mix bus 7. And since they're not subgroup and it's post fader, you know, you're going to have separation there, and you should just have your background vocals on 7. Okay, great. I'm glad that we could help on that. Now, actually, I wasn't very clear on that, Henry, so thank you for bringing that up. So I think at this point, Joe, are we ready to kind of move into the questions and answers period? I guess we kind of already
have. Yeah, I think we pretty much made it through the whole presentation. So, yeah, we'll just move into some questions. And I know Justin is also set up with a camera and an X32 and P16 gear.
Yeah, actually, while we're waiting for questions to come in, Justin, would you want to show us a couple of things with the P16M?
Sure.
I think maybe if I know I explained how with saving and the recall, and just so you guys can see what it looks like when it's actually powered up. It's a really neat little mixer. And definitely just any questions you guys have, just fire away. You know, even if it's not about the P16, we'll get to it a little bit later. We have plenty of time.
You know, John, I'm reading through the questions right now. There's kind of an interesting question. I hadn't really thought of this. The question is, does no additional equipment mean that I can use the S16 with the P16M, for instance, in a rehearsal situation without the X32?
Yeah, I saw that. I was wondering the same thing. Maybe, because I know the S16 has a lot of different modes that determine like what goes in and out of each. You know, like I know for the ADAT it has different things you can do. So maybe we'd have to check on that, though. I haven't tried it.
It's a great question, and I'm sorry we don't have an answer for that one. But I'm going to look into that because that's very interesting. Because I know that you can change the parameters remotely, you know, in the S16, I wonder if you can also change what's feeding, like maybe you can do some sort of direct out, you know, from any input coming in or something. But as far as I know, you can't, but we'll definitely look into that so we have a definitive answer on that one.
Hey, John, if you want to pass the screen over to me, I can show some of the tips that you'd mentioned earlier.
Sure, I'll pass that.
It's not allowing me to grab the...
Yeah, I'll pass it to you in a second. And in the meantime, good question here from Zach. It says, how many S16s can be on one AES50 port? The AES50 is a 48 by 48 channel protocol in our application because we're running at 48K. So that means with the S16s being 16 by 8, you know, if doing the math, you actually can put 3 of them on each AES50 port. So the X32 can actually address up to 6 S16s. Now, just remember that, of course, you're only going to bring in 32 channels at a time for mix, but there are some cool scenarios where that would be helpful. For example, if you have a festival scenario with a lot of different bands, and instead of having to go up on stage and pull different mics and plug into different, you know, you would just have a scene on the X32 that would go to that would just address the SX16 when the next band went on. Or maybe you'd have S16s in different rooms of a church or something. Maybe you have an X16 down in the youth room, and you'd be able to pull that in if you needed it. So you can address up to 6 if you're utilizing both AES50 ports. And let me give you the screen here, Justin. Sorry about that.
It's okay. Okay, great. Thanks, John. So I just wanted to take a minute to show one of my favorite features of the P16M, which is the ability to be able to save settings and store different various settings on your 16 channels, and then also be able to have the ability to do a total recall and bring up, you know, the various different settings that you have saved. So I just wanted to show you guys real quickly how to do that. So you'll notice right now that we have the main button selected. To show the overall mix or the overall mixer, to select each channel and to see the various different settings, EQ, panning, volume, etc. Then we have the main button to show the overall mix. Now, To store and to save the mix, you simply want to press and hold the fourth button under the setup in the top left portion of the P16M. You press and hold the store button. You'll notice that one of the channels lights up with a green indicator. This just indicates that you have previously stored something on that channel or used that channel. So for our purposes here, we're going to press and hold the same channel, and you'll notice that it is now showing a red and green indicator, and then we press it a second time to save it. The store button will disappear, the indicator button under the store button will disappear, and you'll know that that has been saved. Now let's make some changes just on the main screen here, or on the main part of the mixer here. Let's do some panning and pan our mix all the way over to the right. Not all the way over, but just almost all the way over so that we can see two buttons here. And then we'll also reduce the main volume encoder, bring it down here. Just to show you that we've made some changes, we'll also make some changes on the EQ as well. And let's store these, save these changes. So again, we're going to hit the store button, press and hold it. Once again, the fourth channel is flashing to indicate that that's previously what we've selected, but this time we're going to save it on the fifth channel. Once I press the channel 5, you'll notice that the red and green indicators are flashing, and then I will, as I mentioned, press it a second time to save it. Now, to showcase these differences, let's do a recall. So to do a recall, we're going to press the third button on the top left area under the setup section under the P16M. We press and hold the recall button, and again, the indicator is showing us the channel that was previously used or selected. In this case, let's bring up channel 4 where we saved our initial settings so that we can see the difference. And to do that, I'm going to select channel 4 and deselect the recall button, and you'll notice the change in the volume, overall volume, as well as the panning. We had it pan slightly to the left. Now let's do recall and showcase the fifth channel just to show those changes one more time. So to do that, again, I press and hold the recall button, and then I press the fifth channel and let go of the recall button, and you'll notice the volume changes as well as the changes in the panning on the main mix. And that is how you do a store and a recall on the P16M.
I just wanted to point out, just to really clarify, that so you have 16 memory locations, so this just allows you to build, you know, a different mix possibly for different sections of a show, you know, that you might be working on. Or, you know, a band could have one preset for set 1 and one preset for set 2, etc. So that's going to save, you know, into each one of those memory positions the complete mix of where you have all 16 channels set, where they're panned, where they're EQ'd. You know, your complete mix preset is being able to be stored and recalled. Something we didn't really mention is on the EQs, since there's just one set of encoders up at the top, it's kind of like your channel strip. When you go from, say you have kick drum on channel 1 and snare drum on channel 2, if they're EQ'd very differently, when you go to channel 2, you actually have to sweep the EQ to grab where the frequency was set on that other channel. I remember the first time I used it, it took me a few minutes to kind of get that, because it sounded like the EQ wasn't doing anything on an individual channel, and I realized that I had to sweep the knob until it grabbed where the frequency was set for that particular channel, which is actually common on certain encoders. So.
Right, so basically if that encoder isn't lit up bright red like the treble is right now, it's not doing anything. It doesn't actually change the sound until you hit that point where you were before, which is, as Joe said, is pretty desirable in this scenario.
Yeah, and it's also, as John said, it's totally visual. Once you see it, when the light, you know, gets much more intense, then that's where you were on that particular channel on say, the frequency or the cut boost kind of thing.
Cool. So yeah, if anyone has any, I know we got a couple of questions about the EQ. I think that kind of clears it up. It's basically you just need to, as Joe said, you just have to turn that knob, and then once it's bright red, then the EQ is kind of active. You can make changes and and then you'll notice.
You know what, Justin, since we're on the camera, can you also demonstrate so it's really clear about the that main switch? When you're back on the main switch, just keep in mind, as John said, the volume encoder, which is all the way to the right. You want to put your hand on that, Justin, the volume encoder? Is now your mix bus out, which is feeding your output. The level up above it where it says output is just your headphone level, but this is like your master bus level for the entire 16 inputs. So as John said, if you find that, geez, we were getting a number of calls that they were saying that the P16 wasn't loud enough, even though they had the level totally cranked up at the top, and we realized that they just had their master bus barely on, and yet they were cranking their headphone level all the way up. I personally really like this. Like in a live situation, you know, definitely have your musicians leave it on that main screen. And if something goes wrong, if something starts feeding back in their ears or whatever, they can just hit that button, and it's a master kill switch for everything going to the bus output on the P16 on that one particular unit. And as Justin just showed, it's just like a kill switch.
Hey, Justin, can you sweep that bass EQ knob all the way around? Yeah, there you go. We must have just had it at a different spot. A couple people were asking because it didn't look like it lit up before, but it must have been at the extreme, maybe left or right or something. Awesome.
Okay. I'm not sure if I understand this question. Does the bus send, are they auto-linking on the P16M?
I think I might have answered that. I think he means that, you know, when I set up those stereo submixes, for example, on the drums, does the P16 automatically, you know, since it's a stereo subgroup, will the P16 automatically, you know, left and right pan it? And the answer is actually it won't, because when you're sending those signals out the P16 routing menu on the X32, you're just sending a bunch of audio. You're sending 16 channels of audio, and the P16 is, you know, just like a regular mixer. So you do have to tell it. It doesn't know that you have a stereo pair coming in 3/4, so you just have to link them. Justin, can you just do that real quick? You just press the link button, and if you press yep. 3, it'll just automatically link to the adjacent one, number 4.
So this is, you know, a perfect example is, you know, a stereo keyboards where you have a left and right output. You know, it'd be nice just to be able to link those channels together. It'll hard pan, you know, 3 all the way left and 4 all the way right. And also your level control is now going to add, you know, just pull up the left and right channel equally together, so you don't have to make individual adjustments for a stereo input. One thing that I really love on the P16 is, you know, you're in a lot of situations where you might have a full set of drum mics where you have a kick mic and snare, hi-hat, toms, overheads, etc. Say you're using 8 channels just for drums. You can go in and, you know, pan everything out the way you want it, get it all EQ'd, set the relative levels between where you want everything to sit in the mix, and then you use that that group button up at the top, and then just group all your drum tracks together. It makes a perfect little subgroup of drums, and then when you select any of the drums in that little group, the volume encoder is just bringing that whole subgroup up and down, so you don't have to do that individually. So it's great for situations where you have multiple mics like that.
We had a question about the volume knob on the right, the actual output volume knob. Is that always lit up? I think it is, right?
Yeah.
I don't think that's part of your recall, is it, Joe?
No, it's not, because that's just like a like your output. So,
right.
But what's cool is the limiter, and I don't know if you have signals running through this or not, Justin. But the limiter, threshold, you know, as you turn that threshold to the left to drop the threshold down, the LED glows more and more as you're limiting the signal, which is very cool.
somebody asked if all the linking and group settings are saved in the 16 memory locations. Yes, pretty much everything else except for how you have that output section is saved. You know, your EQ, your pan, volumes.
Yeah, I think it was a bit of a safety thing, you know, where obviously you want to be very careful with the master level that's feeding someone's in-ears or a powered wedge. Somebody's ear might be near it, and you change presets, and it jumps way up in level. So if we have any dead time, if you want to switch back to John's screen, I know there were a couple of earlier questions about how we configured the something about the audience mic and a few of the other channels.
Oh, I went through that. He was asking about how to do it like a mono subgroup, and basically on the X32, the way that if you're using a subgroup, it's basically going to be a pair. And so we went through that. If you wanted to do, it was for the background vocals, so we didn't need that to be stereo. So instead of using like a 7/8, we just used 7. And the way I did that was just by doing a post fader send, as you can see, and then just sending the vocals to 7, like I have here, those 3 vocals. And then on the right side of that pair, I just sent the computer stuff, the Mac and the DVD. And then because it's a post fader send, not a subgroup, those are going to be totally separate. So I can assign, you know, 7 to one channel on the P16 and 8 to another, and I'll be good to go.
I'm just looking up the MIDI implementation thing. I just want to verify it's in the manual, and then we can pull it up.
Are you looking at the PDF, Joe?
Yeah. Yeah, you know what it is? It's on the... you want to switch to my screen, I can show everybody where to get to it.
Gotcha.
So if you just go to Behringer.com, right on the main page, if you just click on the P16M, I think it's right beside the X32, it'll bring up the product page for the P16M. And if you, this section of the screen right here is where you can get to any of the manuals. So it was the one that's under preset sheet. It says English. And when you click on that, this actually came up. So this is giving you your control change numbers, your MIDI CC numbers, like 21, 22, 23, 24. And exactly what those numbers are changing. Those are the EQ section, you know, volume, pan, etc. I guess I can cut that link out and send that out to you guys.
No problem, Henry. I hadn't known that was in that exact spot either, so it's great. Joe, while we have your screen and we're waiting for any other questions to come in, do you want to just give a quick overview for service if anyone needs any information on that?
Sure. Yeah, I'll do that in 1 second. While we still have my web up, I was just going to show you, obviously, if you're an X32 owner, I'm sure everybody does this quite often, but you just go to the product page. And in the middle, there's your download section. And just check here for any of your firmware upgrades. We're at 1.09 right now. I think in the next 2 weeks, we should be probably getting the 1.10 coming up. Yeah, since we had a little dead time with the questions, I just wanted to mention that beginning at the last NAMM show, about eight months ago, we made it a major announcement that we now have a 3-year warranty. So, you know, this is something, once again, that's going to be really important on a product like the P16 system, especially when you're using them in stage environments. So just wanted to mention how we came about increasing our warranty from a 1 year to a 3 year. And also keep in mind that if you do buy a Behringer product, you do need to register the product once you, otherwise it's just a 1 year warranty. If you register it, you get an additional 2 years. How we arrived at this is basically with the purchase of Midas and Clark Technic. Uli Behringer, the owner of our company, spoke to them about what would it actually take to manufacture some Midas products at our factory in China. And basically Midas came back with a wish list, you know, that was had quite a price tag associated with it to basically get the quality that they needed for their products. The investment was $20 million, and this was done over the past, you know, a few years. Uli went ahead and did it. He invested $20 million into the manufacturing capabilities of our factory. And we spent $8 million just in new automation machinery. We made the largest purchase of audio precision test equipment in the world. So there's extensive testing that's going on. And it really was a very win-win situation for both Behringer brand and for the Midas brand, because Behringer quality came up remarkably, you know, with this $20 million investment and the increased, you know, audio testing, et cetera. And on the Midas side, they were able to offer a product, you know, like the Pro One, where they, for the first time ever, broke the $10,000 price point. So it's really been an excellent situation. Obviously, on the Behringer side, one of the things that we were able to do is offer a three-year warranty. I always tell people, don't take our word for it. Tommen, who's, I believe, the largest Behringer dealer in the world at this point, basically they publish their failure rates for each manufacturer. The second green arrow is showing a 0.77% defect rate for the Behringer brand over a three-year period. So that's the biggest dealer selling the most amount of Behringer gear, and that's their actual data, not ours. So pretty remarkable what's happened over the past 3 years with the quality of Behringer products. Wanted to also talk about service. Any X32 users out there, always keep in mind that in the U.S. anyway, we have the Las Vegas repair facility. If you're located here, that 702 number will get you right into that facility. Option one will get you into tech support. Chase McKnight is our main guy on the X32. And he can answer a lot of questions with products as sophisticated as the X32 and the P16 and the S16. Some of the things that are coming in that people think they have a service issue, turns out that it's just a routing issue or something really simple. So if you're ever having an issue, just call into Chase, as well as you can always, you know, email myself or John any of those questions as well. So just wanted to throw that out there as well. And this was a comparison chart that we did. I know that it's not related to what we're talking about, but this is we did a comparison chart. One thing that is directly related to this is to the P16 is our latency rate. And our latency is 0.8 milliseconds. That's the bottom spec. I think it's the third one up from the bottom. If you look at, you know, like the Studio Live, the LS9, or even the, you know, a $12,000 GLD, you know, 0.8 milliseconds, that's the lowest latency rate of any digital mixing board on the planet. Even the best Midas stuff, you know, big Yamaha consoles, I mean, we're at 0.8 milliseconds. It's really, really amazing. On Studio Live, you're up at 3 milliseconds, LS9, 2.5, and 1.49 on the GLD, so pretty cool. Obviously, latency when you're getting into a monitoring system like the P16 is going to be very important.
Yeah, Joe, I'm glad you brought that up. And also worth mentioning that if you are using, I know for that the P16 system, you know, if say you're using it standalone, even with the P16i, it's still less than a millisecond of latency. So, you know, you have less than a millisecond coming out of the P16 and less than a millisecond coming, you know, through the X32. So it's, as Joe said, for in-ear monitors, that's crucial. And you're definitely going to be sitting pretty well at that latency rate. One other thing about this chart that I think is pretty amazing is just the cost. And of course, you guys are probably all aware of that. But if you look at some of the other solutions out there, how much it would cost to get personal monitoring. It's, it makes the P16 that much more exciting.
That's a really great point. In the middle of the chart, where we get into the cost for four users, it's pretty remarkable when you take a look at this. And we haven't even talked at all about, you know, price points and all that on the P16. But you know, depending on what country you're in, because I know we have people calling in from all over the world, definitely check, you know, check on what the different pieces cost in your country. I know in the U.S. It's an extremely affordable solution compared to AVIOM was a system that's been used for years for 16-channel discrete monitoring. And as I mentioned earlier, you're well into, you know, $2,000 to $6,000 before you have a functioning, you know, system. Whereas with the P16, you could get started with, you know, just a couple of P16Ms and a P16D, and you're still well under $1,000. Yeah, so it's a very, very affordable system.
Okay, great. Looks like we have some stuff here.
Not to mention, on John, I think you pointed this out when you looked into the LS9. You only have two expansion slots on the LS9, and if you're using a digital snake that's already using those two slots, you don't even have a slot open to put in an AVIOM card. So on the X32, you got AES50 for a digital snake, and you have that dedicated ultranet. So pretty,
yeah, that's a great point, Joe. A lot of other mixers are going to require you to, you know, purchase a card to set up your personal monitoring, and you know, it's almost like you have your ultranet card is basically already built in at no additional cost. So that is a really great point. Couple questions here, Joe. Have we had any updates on the shipping of the S16?
You know, I'm still sticking to the end of November. I know we're obviously into November, but I've been hearing reports that they're hitting the stores. So,
yeah, I think I've even got a couple of questions about them. I know, I'm pretty sure they've left our factory at this point. Have you heard that, Joe?
Yeah, no, I knew that they were, you know, on the way, and everything that I heard was the third and fourth week of November, but I think they might have made it in a little bit sooner, so I would just check your local distributor for that.
Okay, and just keep in mind that shipping from our factory, by the time it gets to a store, it could be 6 to 8 weeks, so we're probably in the middle of that window right now in some countries. That's why maybe it gets to some certain countries before others. Steve was asking, you know, it looks like we definitely have some time, and he asked about the difference between DCAs and regular subgroups. I'd be glad to take that for you. Basically, the main difference is that DCAs are not an actual audio path. A DCA is strictly a volume control. So that's not like a subgroup, where if you're sending channels to a subgroup, excuse me, you're actually mixing those channels together. There's so you can process them. The way what this means to you is that DCA, because it's not an audio path, you can't process it as a group of channels. The audio is not being summed, so you can't do, you know, compression on that group or EQ on that group or even meter that group, because it isn't an actual group of channels. It's just a volume knob. Subgroups is an actual audio path. So if you wanted to do EQ on a, you know, maybe you want to do the same EQ on a bunch of microphones, or you wanted to do parallel compression on a drum kit, that's where you'd want to use subgroups. But the DCAs are a nice advantage, because a lot of times in the past, people would use subgroups just to get that volume control. You know, on analog mixers, you might have 8 subgroups, and you'd have your, you know, a pair for your drums, a pair for your vocals, a pair for your instruments, and a pair for your effects. And, you know, there goes your subgroups. Well, on the X32, you know, maybe you really only need the processing on the drums as a whole. And the rest of the instruments, you know, you don't really need the process. Well, then you can kind of mix and match and use these, put everything, because subgroups can actually be assigned to DCAs as well. So you can kind of combine, you know, the use of the two and assign a sub, you know, if you're doing like a parallel compression on drums, you could assign all the drums and the drum subgroup to the same DCA fader. And then again, you're only using one fader, because you don't need to have one for left and right. So I hope that clears it up. If not, feel free to ask some more.
John, for some reason I'm not seeing my GoToWebinar screen. Are we on the generic screen or still on mine?
You're sharing the chart still.
Oh, okay, cool.
Barney asked.
I was just going to share, John, if we have a little bit of dead time. I know.
I got some questions now.
Oh, you do? Okay, cool.
We have, can I see the webinar later because I just got in? Yes, we actually are. We just started posting these up right now on our YouTube channel. We have the first webinar we did a few weeks back. So give us a week or so and we'll have this up as well. And since you just got here, let me just give you that link one more time. This is the link to the first webinar, and that'll also get you to our YouTube channel, which is where the other webinars will be posted. So, you know, check back there in a week or so, and hopefully we'll have that up. We're also going to be posting our routing webinar and our Pro Tools webinar fairly soon. Let's see.
I was just going to share, this is a shot that John took this past weekend. He had an opportunity to go to a facility called the AG Performing Arts Center in Albany, New York. And it's quite a theater. I mean, it's really, they use some very high-end, they've got a Midas Heritage Council at front of house position, and I believe all the cabinets are what, Meyer cabinets, and they wanted to try out an X32 at monitor position, and John had an opportunity to go up there, and this was a shot from the side of the stage, John, is that correct?
Yeah, I was standing right behind the monitor guy there, yep.
And then over the weekend, they mixed Bella Fleck came in, who's a pretty big performer, so pretty cool. We also had an X32 out with ZZ Ward, who's kind of an up-and-coming female artist. She was on the Jay Leno show the other night, and they used an X32 on their West Coast tour last week, which was pretty cool.
Let's see here.
John, have you seen this question from Dave about using the S16 as a return?
Let me see. Yeah, I was reading that. Since no separate main out on X32 using all 6-inch Ramones.
John, why don't we switch to your screen with X Control? Do you want to just mention, if we have a few minutes, about using the P16 bus, even if you're not using P16?
Sure. I'm just trying to figure out this question here. So no separate main out on the X32 using all 16s for monitors, using AES 50 to send to local processing. How can I then send that back through the S16 as a return? Well, you would have to connect the analog outputs from your processor to two of the inputs on the S16. And it would be just like you plug the mic into the S16. That's the only way I think that's what you meant. If I can clarify that, just no AES standard for main outs. But the S16 doesn't actually have the S16 doesn't have any digital output except for those ADAT outs, those two banks of ADAT. So I don't think you'd be able to route AES back in. Are you trying to come, Dave? Are you trying to come out of your local processor and then get it down the S16? Got it. Okay, so you'd have to return the signal from your processor back through the X32 somehow, and you don't have AES in the AES EBU jack on the X32 is just an output. So you'd have to do it in the analog domain. Maybe your processor has a pair of XLR outs, or maybe even quarter inch outs, and you can go into the auxiliary inputs on the X32. And then you could route those down the S16. Basically, the way you would do that, and I'm going to go back to, am I on the screen now, Joe?
No.
Okay, take it back.
What are we showing right now?
I'm just showing how to route something out the S16.
I mean, what is showing up on everyone's screen?
My screen should be up now.
Okay.
So say you came back in. Let's see. Okay, cool. So Dave gets it. So basically, if you're coming back in analog, Dave, just to get that out your S16, you'll notice on the routing menu, if you're, say you're using the AES50A port, and you notice how you have this, it's hooked up right here to, you know, out 1 through 8 and out 9 through 16. So if you go to these correspond to whatever is set up on the analog out page. So if you're returning out of your processor using a balanced quarter inch into the AUX jacks on the back of the X32 because you're using all of your mic ins, then that's no problem. You can just select whatever those outputs you want, go to direct out, and take a direct out tap, you know, from, let's say, AUX 1 and 2, and then you can return your signal that way. Just make sure that if you're doing this, you're probably going to want to make sure you go to those AUX channels and go to the main area and make sure they're not going out to left, right, because you're just trying to use those to route it through. So hopefully that helps. And while I'm in there, I just want to mention that the P16 outs have that same kind of routing capability. So maybe even if you're not using the P16 and you're looking for ways to get signal down and you're having trouble with the whole blocks of eight concept on the output page, you notice you have P16 output here. So just like with analog out 1 through 8, you know, say you're not using the P16 and you want to record to your FireWire card, you know, with some channels, you can select P16 out 9, 1 through 8, and then anything you set on this P16 out tab is 1 through 8. We'll go down that pipe. So that's another way you can get your AUX inputs to go right to a recording card or out of the AES50 to the S16.
John?
Yeah.
When you have a dead spot, we could switch back to me, and I know we didn't really show the P16i. Because this is specifically, it was you know, using the X32 with the P16. But if we have some time, I could show a few slides with that.
Sure. Once we still have a couple of questions coming in from Kenny. It says, we just purchased an X32 and we are in Seattle. Do you have a local X32 expert? Well, you're in luck. We actually do. We have Dwayne on the call here, and he should be right in the neighborhood. Dwayne, can you get on here? Say hello. Not sure if Dwayne's mic is on.
Hello, how are you? I'm on. How are you?
So that's
great. Yeah, this is Dwayne Wheeler. Dwayne lives up in the Seattle area, which is actually also where our U.S. corporate office is.
Yeah, so we can definitely get somebody in touch with you. I will send you a message with my email for now, or I guess I could even send you Dwayne's email.
You could send my email.
Yeah, perfect. And that, Dwayne, that's prodsupnwamer.
Yeah.
All right. I'm sending that to everyone in case anyone else is in the Seattle area. That is Dwayne. And he'd be glad. I'm sure Dwayne would be glad to see you.
Yep. Great. Thanks.
Thank you. We also have a question about Waves plugins on a Midas Pro Series via AES50. This is possible, but I think that what you would need is the Clark Technic network bridge. I forget the model number of it, but it's a DN and then a DN something. I'd have to check, but it's a network bridge that would allow you to interface AES50 to, you know, either MADI or something else that you can interface with a computer. That would be the way you would need to do it to get, so it can be done. But the Midas Pro Series, they don't have FireWire USB, you know, right there. So you'd have to, if you're going to use AES50, you need some sort of way to get in and out of the computer. And the way most people do it, at least definitely on the pro level, is that they get the Clark Technic network bridge, and they convert it to MADI, and then they use a MADI interface with their computer. I actually just read a really cool article about that. I'll see if I can send you the article in a moment that. Where someone was describing just that. Another question says, see if I got this right. Use the P16D with the X32 and use the P16I if you don't have an X32. and X16 can provide connectivity from the X32 also. Yes, Steve, that's right on. Exactly.
Wow, somebody's putting together a pretty big system. They just got their X32. This is Kenny with 10 P16Ms and 3 P16Ds. That's awesome.
He was the gentleman in Seattle looking for the local products support specialist.
Oh, great. Yeah, I also wanted to mention that we've recently just added in a House of Worship product specialist. So if there's anybody out there with you know, any churches that need us to come down and do a hands-on demo or show you guys any of these pieces actually at your facility, please feel free to definitely get in touch with us.
Awesome. Dave Smith is excuse me. He's asking if using the UFX card, can I route an AUX into the UFX somehow? I think what you're saying is, can I route an aux in to my computer? And yeah, absolutely. The best. There's two ways to do it. On the routing menu, you're going to go to card out, and then by default, you're going to see, you know, local 1 through 8, 9 through 16, because you're sending your direct out to your mic preamps. So the easiest and simplest way, if you have channels to spare and you don't mind losing a bank of 8, you can just go down here to aux 1 through 6 / mon, and then that'll go ahead and you know, whatever, that'll take the signals plugged into your TRS jacks and send them down the recording card. Alternatively, you can do what I mentioned before, and you could select, you know, what, let's say you need those channels. You could say out 1 through 8, and then go over to the analog out page, and, you know, you can say 1 is going to be direct out of aux 1, 2 is going to be direct out of aux 2, and then you still have, you know, and then you can actually, you know, say the rest of them you want to be actual channels. You can just go to 3 and say direct out of channel, whichever channel you need, and you can go ahead and set those 8 outputs out. And as long as you select output 1 through 8 here on the card out screen, out 1 through 8, that's a way you can kind of route it through. And you can do the same thing. Say maybe you're using, you don't have a P16 and you're using all your outs for headphone mixes. You can use your P16 buses and do the exact same thing. Assign channels to P16 outputs and then send those outputs down the card.
Yeah, I know that was definitely a trick that helped a lot of people out, because normally you would look at that P16 tab, and if you weren't using P16, then you wouldn't think of using that to route, but just use it as a routing method to route back down the card, as John said.
Yeah, it's like another additional routing matrix that you can use. Question from Steve about X control with crossover can be used to configure a scene on a Mac and then uploaded via USB key. Yeah, that's exactly, I don't know if you noticed when I was switching tabs, but that's what I'm using. I've never used this program before. I'm on a trial. I got it yesterday, but it's working really well. And I think it's about 50 or 60 bucks to buy. But so if anyone can't wait for, you know, for the Mac version to come out, it's a pretty reasonable solution. It allows you to run some Windows programs without actually having to buy Windows. So yeah, you can Google crossover if any of you are interested in that. And
I know, John, you just set that up yesterday, and seems like you've been having pretty good luck with it.
Yeah, exactly. It's been really good. It doesn't take up nearly as much resources as something like Parallels would.
Both John and I have Parallels loaded on our Mac, and for certain corporate things we have to do, we have to sometimes go into it, and it's sort of like the dreaded Parallels every time we load it, because it just kind of eats up so many resources. So this will be a nice solution.
Yeah, and then there's another free solution called like Wine Bottler, and I know some people have had luck with that. You definitely want to be a little more on the techie side, because I think there's quite a few steps to getting it running, but you're welcome to check that out as well. It's called Wine Bottler.
Dave Smith, what does out 1 through 8 mean in card out?
It means out 1 through 8. Out 1 through 8 means when you're looking at – it means the same thing on the card tab as it does on the AES tab. And what it's basically mirroring whatever it means, analog out 1 through 8 would have been, we probably should have put a little A there, but basically it means analog out 1 through 8, and that's going to be set right on that analog out page. So it's going to mirror whatever you have going on for these first 8. So whatever you assign here, that's what's going to go down that 1 through 8. So that's why that's where you get a little bit of flexibility, where you can route 1 to 1. Since your analog outs are individually assignable, you can assign anything you want to these 8 outputs, and then you can go to card out and choose out 1 through 8, and you can get anything down that card pipe. And you do not need an additional Windows license for crossover or wine bottle, or I think that's one of the main things people are drawn to it for. So I don't know how it does with any other program. I just know that X-Control is a pretty small little exe file. That's so it does pretty well with that.
John, I think I'll for some reason I actually don't have the option to show my screen right now. Do you want to switch back to me and I'll go through the P16i?
Yeah, absolutely. You should have the dialog box.
I just want to mention that Dave has mentioned that he's using Reaper, to go along as a 32-channel live recording, and it's working great. That's software that individuals can use for multi-track recording on a Windows platform. We will be, I think, hosting a webinar specifically covering Reaper coming up here in the next coming weeks as well. So make sure to tune in for that if you have any specific questions with Reaper.
Yeah, it's a great affordable program. You can download it and use it for free. And then I think to get a license is pretty inexpensive. And it does run on Windows and Mac. And yeah, we've had some success with that on the X32. So thank you for that.
Just wanted to mention, since we're talking about digital audio workstations, that we a few weeks ago we got NFR copies of Sonar, and one of the guys in our product specialist team has been working with it to try to work out some of the issues that people are having. And so far we've been able to get audio in and out, but we've been in contact with Cakewalk, and we're trying to there's some things on their end that aren't implemented. Which they're working on to add to their next release, so some of those control surface functions will work. We see a lot of those questions up on sound forums and some of the different forums about trying to get Cakewalk to work. But the X32 is really solid on those control surface functions. We've had great luck with Pro Tools and Logic, and some in Reaper as well. Just to confirm, John, is the P16i up on the screen?
Yep, you're good.
Okay, cool. Yeah, I just wanted to mention this is the P16i that we mentioned earlier. This is obviously a piece that you would use if you're not using an X32. It's just a single 19-inch rack unit. On the front, you just have the outputs. You have the 6 alternate outputs, which would feed out to your P16Ms. And then all the way on the left, you have the where you can see 1 through 16. These are just going to show you if you have a signal coming in on that particular channel. You're going to see those little LEDs light up. And on the back, you have your connectivity. Let's see. For analog inputs on the back, you have 16 TRS balanced inputs. So you could feed those from direct outs on an analog console, or different bus outputs, aux sends, however you want to feed those to feed those 16 P16 channels. That's on that side. On the front, you also have 4 position gain switches, so you have a little bit of level control, just to sort of trim those different analog inputs that are coming in, and obviously the signal indicators. On the back, you also have ADAT ins. So if you look, you have an A port, that's for channels 1 through 8, and you have a B port for 9 through 16. And what's kind of cool about this is you can mix and match. You have to do it in, you know, groups of eight, but if you wanted to use, say, channels 1 through 8 for TRS analog inputs, and then you wanted to use the B input on the ADAP port for 9 through 16, you could also do it that way, or vice versa. So this is just, you know, it's another way to utilize the P16 system. If you don't have an X32, even if you're in a studio environment and you have a Pro Tools rig or whatever that has some ADAT outputs, you could use that to feed a whole queue system for a studio, just using that P16i. So that is the P16i.
Awesome. Thanks, Joe. We got another question about the preamps on the S16, and yes, I can say that the preamps and the whole AD front end, I believe, is exactly the same on the S16 on the X32. Is that correct, Joe?
Yeah, that's correct. Yeah, they're the identical. The S16 are the identical mic pres as the X32.
Yeah, which is a really great benefit on there, because, you know, instead of running 200 feet, you know, on an analog cable and having all that signal loss, you're getting that same quality conversion, you know, right at the stage, maybe 15 feet, maybe 30 feet tops from the mic. And so it just makes for a nice clean signal.
Yeah, and, you know, the that's a great point, because the converters as well in the S16 are the identical converters that are in the X32. And those converters are, you know, they're the same converters that are used on, you know, $50,000 digital consoles. I mean, they're really high-end converters. They really sound great. Somebody's asking about Digital Performer. That's a really good question. I haven't heard a single user mention Performer.
Usually no news is good news, so I'd imagine it's been working. But, you know, with the X32 in general, on the Mac end, it's Core Audio compliant, and on the PC side, we have ASIO and WDM drivers. So it should work with virtually anything. Most of the problems we've encountered have had to do with the control surface and how certain programs implement the Mackie template or the Huey template. And that's kind of been, that was our stumbling block with Sonar, I know. So usually, for the most part, with a little bit of configuration, I haven't heard anyone say that they, you know, I haven't heard an example of a DAW yet that just doesn't work. I don't know about you guys.
Yeah, I think, you know, Digital Performer is sort of, you know, it's a real staple, and it's obviously pretty solid. It's been around for years. So I think, just like you said, you know, no news is good news on that one. I think that it probably would work fine. It's funny, on the forums, we get so many questions, and that's why I brought up Sonar, because we don't hear of all the people that are using it with Pro Tools and Logic and more than likely Digital Performer as well.
Right. So we have a question from Dave again about a front-of-house monitor split using the S16 and give both positions control or gain. Well, basically the way it's set up right now is that is theoretically possible, but the way we've implemented it currently, it would have to be whatever console is plugged into the A port on an S16, that's the one that's going to do it. So in order to switch that up, you'd have to physically move those connectors on the stage box. And it's not to say that you know, that is something that we've looked into. I know people have asked about that, but that's the implementation, at least for now. You'd have to be plugged into the A port to control. And of course, since it's a single preamp design, you know, only one console would be able to control it. Another question about two X32s connected directly via AES50. Definitely possible. I've seen it happen. I've seen it done in action before, like a monitor console, front of house console scenario, where you can plug it, you know, you can almost use your monitor console as a stage box, where you plug everything into the monitor console. Of course, you have to trust your monitor engineer to set some conservative gains. But once you, you know, then you can just use the AES50, send everything digitally to the front of house console. And you can route that main left right signal back. And yeah, you can definitely do it.
Yeah, I know a number of guys that are doing that, and yeah, it works well in a lot of situations. Justin, I'm not sure if you saw, there was somebody was asking about the previous webinars, and just to address that, they're definitely available. Right now, the X32 overview webinar is up on our Behringer YouTube channel, and Justin will send out another link to that, but as we do these, they're going to all be coming up. We did one on routing, which we're going to finish up the edit on in the next couple of days, and all the digital audio workstations ones. So yeah, there'll be a whole library available.
Joe, we have a question about the X32 marketing van. Is there do we have any update on when that might be heading back towards the East Coast?
Well, it's up in Seattle area right now, and we're going to be working it down to Los Angeles in time for the NAMM show, which is coming up in January. So after the NAMM show, I would imagine we're going to probably take it back through Chicago and then out to New England area again. So I would say, great. What would that put us in? Probably towards the end of February, mid to late February.
Yeah, and Steve, if you're just looking to get a demo or something on the X32 or some other products, I'm going to send you my email right now. I'm out of the, as you may have heard before, I'm out of the New York City area, but I'm also in Boston quite a bit, and perhaps we can meet up at a dealer or something, or I'll just give you my email here.
Yeah, if it works out, if... being that we have product specialists in five different regions in the U.S., if there's anybody that ever wants to try out a P16, if they already own an X32, you know, feel free to hit us with an email. And all the product specialists have that stuff, so if it's available, we can, you know, possibly even lend something out for you guys to try.
Kenny's asking about two zones for the P16M. I think I'm going to say no on this one because you can't really combine. The Ultranet protocol is just 16 channels, so that's really kind of where it maxes out. The only system I know of that does kind of what you were describing is the Roland one, where you can actually each MIC person can choose, you know, which channels they actually want in their 16. So they're the only ones I think I can think of that have that feature. Of course, you do pay for it, but so yeah, that's kind of the difference. That would be a difference between systems like Aviom and ours and there. Yeah, basically you have to pick a single set of 16 channels for people to pick from.
Right, exactly, Dave. He's saying you can route, but you know, bus outputs to P16, kind of like we demonstrated before. That would definitely overcome the you know, having to get more than 16 channels, you know, do some sub mixes and route the bus outputs as we went over before, but you know, there is the next level after that, like I said, would be, you know, getting a system that you can actually, you know, on the P16, you just have to pick from whatever those 16 sources are, whether they're direct channel outs, whether they're mixed bus outs, whatever you choose on that menu, on that routing screen, that's it that everyone has to choose from. So that's why we suggest you use mixed buses to kind of subgroup some things down. That way you can get all 32 inputs or at least whatever inputs you need into the P16.
I also wanted to mention, while we still have a few minutes, that the Behringer forum, actually at behringer.com, is now totally up and fully functioning. If you go to the main behringer.com and you click on the community button, as I just did, it'll bring you into our brand new forum. And this is very cool. There's a whole X32 mixture family, where we have X32 resources. That comparison chart we showed is up there. Links to the webinars are going to be in the resources area, and then there's a whole pretty active X32 general discussion area. So if you click on that, it'll take you in, and basically you can throw any question out that you want. Chris Painter, who I believe is also on this call, is back in the Seattle office, and he mans a lot of these answers to these questions. John and myself often will jump in there. So it's a pretty active little community. We're also Sound Forums is another one that you guys might want to check out. There's a number of users that use Sound Forums, and I think it's up to 100 and 30-something pages at this point of just forum posts about the X32, so very active forum there as well. And just as a reminder, I know I brought this up at the beginning of the call, but if anybody came in late, we also have a few other events that are going on. We have a X32 and Logic Digital Audio Workstation webinar that's coming up. That is on November 10th, 10 a.m. to 12 noon, so that's this coming Saturday. And right off of this forum page, you could just go in and you click on this link and you could register. And also on Monday the 12th, from 1 p.m. to 3 p.m., we're covering the X32 buses, DCAs, subgroups, matrix mixes, mix buses. So if anybody can join us for that.
Yeah, that's going to be a good one. I know we get a lot of questions about DCA groups versus buses and when to use what, and we're going to go through that in detail. I know we talked for a few minutes about it today, but anyone who wants some clarification on that, I think that'll be a really good one for you.
Now we're down to just the last few minutes. I just personally want to thank everybody for showing up. I know everybody's time is really valuable, but it's a really exciting time for Behringer. We have a lot of really great products coming out. You know, obviously the X32, the S16, the P16 family, and a number of other products that are going to be coming that are all going to work in one big ecosystem of digital products. So it's a really exciting time, and we're going to try to keep this thing going to get the information out there, get you guys up to speed on everything, and give you an opportunity to ask any questions. So. John, you're involved with the event on Saturday, right? The Logic event, because I know you're our Logic guy.
Yep, I'll be there.
Great. Also, I just wanted to throw out, if anybody has any other topics for future events that they want us to cover, please feel free either now to, you know, send it in the question box or later on, if you want to just drop us an email and you need help with a certain area that we're not covering, just let us know.
Oh, wow. Steve is talking about a program called Win on X. And I think someone else brought it up before, but I didn't realize that he says it's only $4.99 on the App Store. So I haven't tried that out yet. Maybe I will. But that might be something you want to try for running X Control. Like I said, X Control is a pretty basic program, so it most likely will work, but haven't tried that particular program just yet.
Somebody was also asking about when will the next version of X Control or the iPad app be out, and I don't have an exact date of release, but I know in the month of December there's a couple of updates that are coming, so hopefully we'll at least see one more before the end of the year.
All right, looks like we're settling down on the questions here. Coming up on
great. Justin, I know normally we cut and paste all the questions before I close the session, so I'm not sure if that's something you want to do. And if we missed anybody's question, either hit us with an email or, you know, in the next minute or so, if you wanted to retype it in. If we did miss your question, we apologize, but we tried to get to everybody. Availability of the P16 and S16 at Guitar Center. I know they're carrying those items. The X32 has been quite a success, so I believe that those are going to be coming into Guitar Center fairly soon. I don't have exact dates, but they should be carrying those. The question on the XI app. Yes, we were totally with you on that. It's definitely one of our highest priorities to get that totally dialed in. Okay, guys, we're at a little after 3. I think we're going to wrap it up for today. And once again, like I said, I just wanted to thank everybody for coming, and hopefully you can make it to future events. And we'll see you guys soon. Thank you.